My name is Mark Ludlow from the Australian Financial Review, and I will be introducing our guest speaker as well as having a chat to him later. Ian Macfarlane is the Chief Executive of the Queensland Resources Council. Prior to joining the QRC, he was a Federal Member of Parliament from 1998 until he retired from Parliament in May 2016. During that time, he served in a number of positions, including as Australia's longest-serving Federal Resources and Energy Minister and the Coalition's longest-serving Federal Industry and Innovation Minister. Like I said, he retired in 2016. He lives in Toowoomba with his wife. Please welcome to the stage. There's lots to talk about. Thank you.
Well, thanks very much, Mark, and it was good of you to remind me that I live in Toowoomba. I don't get there as much as I'd like to, but it is the centre of the universe, and as my office has learnt, there is a lot happening in Toowoomba that we should all be proud of. Can I thank also the team from 3PLUS for inviting me to address your audience here today, and can I respectfully acknowledge the traditional owners on the land in which this event is taking place and pay my respects to their elders past and present and to all community leaders past and present. I would also like to acknowledge the Queensland Parliamentary Media Gallery, who I have not been subjected to before, but always watched with amusement the length that a state media conference goes for compared to a federal conference, federal media conference, and also the MEAA for enabling this address today. And of course, I should acknowledge the sponsors as people who make these things happen. My thanks to Peter for the introduction, and to Mark, I'll save my thanks to you until after we've done the questions and we see how that goes. I should also acknowledge a previous, or he's still current, I'm not, our parliamentary colleague in Christian Rowan, the state member for Moggill. It shouldn't come as any surprise to all of you here today that the resource industry, particularly the coal industry, has bounced back. And we have seen some good numbers coming out of the price again for coal. If we look at these slides on the screens there, you'll see that the coking coal spot price is almost touching $150. Dollars per tonne, $147.55 to be precise, and the thermal coal is holding at around $82.34. Coking coal, which of course is used for making steel, makes up about 75% of Queensland's coal exports. And you don't have to be a world-class mathematician to know that the state's coffers are benefiting from these prices and this contribution, and the contribution made by other minerals, metals, oil and gas. As well, we've seen commodities such as copper, lead, zinc gather some steam over recent times. These benefits, of course, flow on in the form of public spending on important infrastructure, public services, and of course, everything in this room that isn't grown is made from resources, if not from this state, certainly from Australia. There are about 40 minerals and metals in those smartphones we all clutch close to ourselves wherever we go. And even that humble spoon that sits on your table has a really interesting path through manufacture. In terms of the economic contribution that we, the industry, make in this state, our sector directly and indirectly contributes $1 in every $5 to the state's economy, and $1 in every 7 jobs. Sector spending reached out to over 20,000 Queensland businesses last year, boosting the sector's total economic contribution to the state to over $55 billion. Coal, of course, was the largest contributor and accounting for about 58% of direct spending, followed by the gas sector spending around 23% and the metals sector spending 15%. Our resource companies also supported more than 900 community organisations across Queensland, and all of these economic and social benefits were accumulated in 1 year using just 0.1% of the state's landmass. And our resource sector will continue to play a key role in the prosperity of this state for many, many decades to come, with the fundamental drivers of the global demand for high-quality resources remaining strong. It always surprises me that in a city like Brisbane, people don't understand that this is the biggest mining town in Queensland. And in fact, Brisbane is home to some of the largest natural resource businesses in the world and is the gateway to a diverse and rich natural resource wealth that lies in Queensland. 25% of Queensland's gross regional product, $1.04, comes from the resource industry, and it supports 133,000 full-time equivalent positions, or 20%, one in five jobs in this city, are as a direct result of the resource industry. And it's cities like Brisbane and the other towns and cities across Queensland that have helped return $2.2 billion in royalties to the state government in 2015-16, and dare I say, more in the years ahead. That's a big number, but what's it mean in practice? Well, $2.2 billion would pay the wages for every one of our 34,400 school teachers, and that's good because my daughter's one of those, in full-time equivalent terms, or alternatively, 28,600 nurses, or 30,500 police officers. We make an enormous contribution to this state. After quite a few challenging years, we've seen our sector bounce back, as I said earlier. And this was evident not only in the recent state budget, but in our commodity exports and business productivity. And we've learnt to do more with less. If you look at this graph that's up on the screen, you'll see that last year was a new record ever for coal exports in Queensland, with 221 million tonnes of combined thermal and coal leaving this state to our customers across the world. To use those words of Mark Twain, reports of coal's death is greatly exaggerated. We have seen the industry, despite the naysayers and the doomsayers, continue to grow and grow and grow. The fundamental drivers of the demand of Queensland's high quality coal remain strong, and that's why we're continuing to see even more investment in that sector. About 150 kilometres west of Mackay, Q Coal's massive Berwyn coal mine will deliver hundreds of jobs and more than $1.5 billion in much needed investment in that region. That's a big dose of export growth for Queensland's coal, coking coal producers, and is why Japan's JFE Steel is investing in the project as well. This mine will be a significant economic contributor, not only to the state, but just as importantly to local communities. Meanwhile, BMA has committed $250 million to build an 11-kilometre overland conveyor system that will transport coal to the company's Peak Downs mines, from the company's Peak Down mines to the coal handling preparation plant near the Caval Ridge mine. Again, a project that will deliver 400 jobs in construction and 200 jobs long term. In gas and metals, as you can see by the Treasury, Queensland Treasury and Reserve Bank of Australia forecasts that are up on the screen, Queensland resources sector well and truly holds its own in comparison to other export sectors in this state. The bright spots are also showing in the metals sector as well, and base metal prices have improved significantly after a tough few years for zinc, which has risen 38%. And led by 34% over the last 12 months. Others to watch are Altona's Cloncurry Copper, which is moving closer to development, MMG's Dugald River Zinc Project, which is on track, and of course Rio Tinto's $1.9 billion bauxite project at Amrun, which is progressing and scheduled to start production later this year. On the horizon, Queensland has the potential to emerge as a global leader in the bauxite trade, with large reserves of good quality bauxite, along with rare earths of the diamantina, the next frontier we need to meet. Some of these rare earths make up the metals and minerals that keep you connected in your smartphone and are going to have a growing demand across the globe. Obviously, these are elements and metals we can't do without. In terms of our energy source, and a topic that I've watched with great interest, I must say. Energy and the electricity market. This slide shows the shows energy use on the 10th of February this year, one of the country's hottest days this year. And it was a snapshot taken by the national electricity market around 11:20 a.m. in the morning. I know that some of you may have been scared that day that you would have suffered the fate of a blackout, which may have affected your ability to charge your mobile phone and stay in touch with everyone. But the catastrophic impacts of power shortages on hospitals, schools and businesses are really where the issue lies. Of course, on that day, there was some fallout in southern states that have not developed their mineral and gas resources as we have done in Queensland. And there is absolutely no argument, as you can see from the graph, that coal and gas are the heavy lifters in the energy market in 2017. And for those who want to aspire to a 100% renewable target and are offended by my promotion of fossil fuels, can I just say that without the resource industry, without the coal industry and all the industries that surround it, the renewable energy industry would simply not survive. It wouldn't even have the resources to generate its renewable energy. Innovation in Australia is something that I've been passionately involved in for a long time and has transformed our lives significantly over the past century. We could never have dreamed of the many technologies that we have today and those achievements that we've made through innovation over the last 100 years. We didn't just go from the horse and cart to the moon, and we didn't just go from a pick and shovel in mining to driverless vehicles. It's a step-by-step process. So it bewilders me that we should think that we have a situation where we can go from fossil fuels to renewables in less than a decade. I don't understand the thinking behind that, and I don't understand why we would take a backward step on technology for our baseload power industry when there are opportunities to innovate and blend them with renewables. The resources sector is long known for innovation, and from my experience, I've seen firsthand the fact that it is in fact one of the biggest innovators in Australia, and it develops and exports innovation and science all over the world, and Australia is the world leader in developing new innovation for the industry. Our sector can offer a lot in solving the energy problems that are facing Australia at the moment. And that's why we should be looking through the windscreen rather than the rearview mirror when we talk about resolving the issues of energy policy and providing solutions to reliability and skyrocketing costs. When the hottest days roll around next summer, we need to ensure that we have a reliable and secure energy supply, and the coal and gas industry will play its role in that. So why aren't we using more coal? We did some focus groups in Brisbane not long ago to ask people what their views were on coal-fired electricity. And once the real situation was explained to them, they were baffled as to why we'd be shipping our coal offshore and not using it when it is some of the highest quality coal in the world. And people expressed their frustration that like countries, Germany and Japan, for instance, were going full steam ahead to develop reliable and secured coal-fired electricity supply, while Australia sits here hand-wringing and looking stunned. On Monday, the Minerals Council of Australia released a 550-page report into the viability of high-efficiency, low-emission generation and its potential contribution to Australia's energy mix and effect on wholesale electricity prices, especially with impending closures of coal plants in eastern Australia over the next two decades. The report found that heli coal plants fueled by good quality black coal has the potential to replace existing power plants at a price of around $2.2 billion per 1,000 megawatts. 1,000 megawatts is about what you need to power a city of a million people. The report also showed that the lowest cost generation option was to look at a heli when compared to other sources of supply, including renewables. The report found that ultra-supercritical black coal generation costs were between $40 and $78 per megawatt hour, which compared more than favourably to renewable energy costs, which, and remembering that renewable energy is not dispatchable and not available on demand, of around $90 to $171, or roughly double, for solar, and $64 to $116 for wind. And as they're experiencing at the moment, again, not a reliable, dispatchable source of power. If we go to backup power and storage, that cost more than doubles to $211 to $693 per megawatt hour, or eight times what you could generate electricity for from a ultra-supercritical power plant. Part of the answer to energy reliability and affordability going forward, therefore, must be to build high efficiency, low emission coal-fired power stations in Australia, just as other countries right around the world are doing. 1,000 alone being built in Asia as we speak. We see these new innovative plants being built in Asia, North America and Europe. So the question is, why aren't they being built here? It seems to me that it's a no-brainer to ensure that as we see further closures of power, we step into that void with a reliable baseload source of power. We also know, and there was a story on the front page of the Financial Review today, so Mark, I'm sure it was true, that since the closure of Hazelwood in Victoria, Queensland electricity is flowing south during periods of high demand. And that will only increase as more brown coal power stations and old black coal power stations like Liddell in southern New South Wales fail and close. As well, we've got regions like North Queensland who are crying out for reliable, low-cost electricity to provide more jobs and process our raw materials in the northern part of the state. And while talking about energy going south, let's talk about the gas market. And why are we short of gas in eastern Australia? We only need to look to the politics in New South Wales and Victoria to find the answer. And as we look at this chart again, we see that again Queensland energy, in this case gas, is being sent south to support the deficiencies in those states. And it's interesting to note that New South Wales produces only 5% of the gas that it consumes, yet has about half the resource that Queensland has. So why have these states taken the decision not to develop their gas, to put moratoriums in place? And the answer is because anti-fossil fuel activists have hijacked the political and public debate through their well-funded misinformation campaigns and scared politicians into inaction and freezing gas development in those states. We are living in a rapidly changing world, and 2017 sees a green activist with the ability to cause undue amounts of disruption and delay in influencing decisions in the resource sector. Extreme green foreign-funded activists attempt to usurp the will and democratic rights of the Australian and Queensland people using both delaying tactics through court actions and spreading misinformation. And rest assured, that is going to continue. So how do these groups have so much power? Well, as we saw in the Courier Mail from John McCarthy, by using enormous amounts of money, $100 million available to just the top 13 of the 670 organisations listed as environmental groups in Australia, and a substantial portion of that money coming in from overseas. The Green Activist campaign, together with the inaction from southern states to utilise their mineral and gas reserves, is crippling Australian manufacturing and costing everyday Australians their jobs. Green activists are determining public policy using nonsense arguments and with the assistance of gullible journalists and social media platforms. It's time for a dose of reality for the political leaders who've fallen for these arguments and stopped development of resources in their states. It's time those states were brought to account for their reckless behaviour. Other countries, such as Canada, allow those states that support the development of their resources industry to discount the income that they receive from royalties, and in Canada's case, by 50%. When you work out the GST distribution coming out of the Commonwealth Tribunal, we should in Queensland, and we should in Australia, consider a similar system. States like Queensland and Western Australia that make the tough decisions, develop our resources, create jobs, and grow exports shouldn't be penalised in the GST distribution for doing just that. And states that sit on their resources without the political courage to develop them should be penalised. And so the QRC supports the campaign currently underway in Australia to see a discount on royalties when consideration of GST takes place in Australia. That would add almost $100 million to Queensland's coffers at a Treasury level. And again, that's more money we could use for teachers, nurses, police, etc. We also need to address the issue of the role that the resources industry plays in renewables. And the fact of the matter is, as we successfully have done with the campaign that QRC put in place, showed that we need about 220 tonnes of coal for every megawatt of generation coming from a wind farm. That same campaign featured cars and solar panels and showed that it is the resource industry which underpins the renewable energy industry, and we should be working together rather than trying to exclude one industry to the benefit of the other. And those results showed a shift in favourability towards the resources sector after we polled the success of the campaign by around 38%. Can I conclude by just showing this picture? Because it highlights to me that the media need to do their job as well as they ask us in the resource sector to do our job. That is a photo that ran in a national paper and ran on the national public network, the ABC, showing coal on the beach in North Queensland. Of course it wasn't. It was magnetite. It'd been there a long time. It's why we have Magnetic Island. If we are going to have a balanced, fact-based debate that ensures that we protect our environment and develop our economy, we all need to work on our game, journalists included. Thank you for the opportunity to be here today, and I look forward to your questions. I'm hoping this radio mic's on. Yep.
Thanks very much, Ian. Journalists always love being told how to do their jobs, so I'm sure my colleagues are recrafting their questions as they speak, frankly, drawing out them.
20 years of being told how to do mine by journalists, so I just couldn't miss the opportunity.
It's about our time, is it? Look, I'm sure we've got lots of questions from my colleagues, but I thought I'd just get the ball rolling. There's been a lot of talk in the last year, especially from the mining and resources sector, about getting next-generation coal projects in Australia. The high-efficiency, low-emission ones, you pointed out that there's hundreds of them being built across Asia, especially in Japan. I guess the question is, though, and I know the MCA did their report early this week, which we can get to in a minute, talking about the viability of that. But I guess for a lot of people, and especially those in the energy sector, they point to the fact that there hasn't been a coal-fired power station built in Australia in almost 10 years. I know that Brendan Pearson from the Minerals Council has said he's quite confident that Healy coal projects will be built in Australia. I guess from an outsider's point of view, they'll be looking at why aren't investors investing in them? You know, if you read the papers, including the Fin Review, you see every couple of days there's a new investment in in wind or solar projects, and I know you'll probably point to the RET helping to subsidise them to a certain extent. But why aren't people investing in Healey projects? And do you think that the only way that they're going to actually get funded is if they get a taxpayer-funded subsidy through the Northern Australia Infrastructure Facility?
Well, if we had policy certainty, so if you could rely on the same approach to energy policy as we have with defence policy, and a energy policy set now would be adhered to by the next government, then you would have seen investment in coal. Because this technology it didn't emerge yesterday. This technology has been getting better and better and better and better, to the point now where the Japanese are building two coal gasification combined cycle power stations whose emissions will be lower than an open cycle gas generator. And we have sat here in Australia paralysed by a partisan debate on one side which says coal is bad and renewables is the future, when in actual fact virtually every other country in the world has embraced a mix. Now, Martin Ferguson and I probably got on too well. We actually did a lot of things without even needing to have a debate in Parliament. We took the bills in, we agreed, we passed them, and we walked out. We left it to the other ministers to slog it out on other issues. But that sort of bipartisanship wasn't reflected between our parties, wasn't even reflected within our parties, and I won't revisit the 2009 changes to leadership. Sorry, 2010 it was. There were a few there. I got confused there for a minute. But if we were to adopt a policy that said we are going to have a transition to renewables, and when we have the storage options at a reliability and cost level that Australian industry can afford, and not have 20% per annum increases in electricity charges, which we're seeing at the moment, then there would be a place for coal in Australia, as there is in every other country. The other question that just completely befuddles me is that we're now in a situation where the government has stepped in to say there is so little gas available in Australia, we've got to stop exporting it. But that gas is not going to be available to generate electricity from a new gas-fired plant, because the numbers on gas are even worse than the numbers on coal in terms of the potential to build a gas-fired power station, run it, and have a carbon tax. So that is what's stopped investment in the coal industry. We now have a situation where you won't see investment in the gas industry. So my question is, where is the electricity coming from in 5 years' time? Because Liddell is literally stuffed, to use a scientific term. And the brown coal power stations are all being phased out. We in Australia are going to have to make a decision to build two, maybe three, very high-tech, low-emission coal-fired power stations, or face electricity prices that will shut down manufacturing and jobs in eastern Australia. The sooner we all stop the political rhetoric and start doing that, the sooner Australia will restore itself to where we were in 2001 when I first became minister, where we had the cheapest electricity in the OECD. We've now got the most expensive, with the exception of Germany, I think.
You're talking about everyone being on the same page. In the lead up to the release of the Finkel Review, you had pretty much every business and industry group leader. You had the National Farmers Federation, you had the ALP saying, yes, we support a clean energy target. It's your former coalition colleagues who seem to be tearing themselves apart about getting behind this and having a bipartisan approach.
Well, I haven't heard the support for Finkel from the Labor Party on the basis that we set a clean energy target and we have to have that debate about what it should be. And obviously, from my perspective, I think it should be around 700 kilograms per megawatt hour for clean energy. That allows new technologies in coal to come in under that level and be part of that clean energy solution. But I haven't heard the Labor Party say that they'd accept a number like that. I haven't heard some in the Liberal Party coalition say they'd accept a number like that. But unless we're pragmatic, unless we accept that there is no other solution other than massive increases in electricity, we are going to have to build those coal-fired power stations. Now, certainly build them under the Finkel report. I think Finkel's done an excellent job. I don't agree with everything that's in there, but he's certainly made a fist of it, and a clean energy target is something I seem to remember promoting in about 2006 with a Prime Minister called John Howard. We just couldn't quite get lift off, but I think that's where Australia is going to have to go. There is going to have to be a transition, and I think Finkel got more things right than he got wrong.
Just one more quick one before I throw to my colleagues. You're talking about a Healey, saying we definitely do need one as some of the older coal-fired power stations are retired. Do you believe that the private sector will be able to fund it on its own, or will it have to get some kind of tax, either taxpayer-funded subsidy or guarantee from the Commonwealth that they actually purchase the power that's produced from?
Well, I mean, a PPA, a power purchase agreement, would be handy, but it's not essential because other power stations will need to compete. So it's not just a case of building a power station, it's building it where it can feed into the grid and compete with the less efficient. It needs some sort of surety in terms of carbon pricing and where we go forward with carbon pricing. There is a view that carbon pricing is inevitable. I think that's probably the case. That's something that's supported by a lot of industry in Australia to give certainty, but obviously there would need to be a transition to a carbon price. If you have a clean energy target that runs for a period of time, and then you understand that on the back of that there may be a carbon price, or if going forward you'll give the investor certainty you need. But we do need to start nailing things down. These debates that ebb and flow between 100% renewable and no coal and the reality of blackouts need to be sorted.
So if the private sector is not going to fund it, it does need a loan, concessional loan of some sort from the Northern Australia Infrastructure Facility to get off the ground?
Well, look, I always love seeing infrastructure built, and it's no secret that it'd be great to see a power station built in North Queensland. There's demand in North Queensland for about 400 megawatts in terms of the processing in the nickel refinery, which I accept is not operating at the moment, but certainly the copper smelter is, Sun Metals are. To build a power station that's efficient, you need to be able to establish it in the market, so any form of government support would be welcome. But I don't discount the possibility that under an accepted clean energy plan for Australia, the commercial reality is based on cost, because every other country is doing it, quite frankly, that you could get a coal-fired generator to work. Probably not in North Queensland, probably in southern Queensland or perhaps southern New South Wales, but the opportunity's there.
I've got plenty more questions, but I don't seem like I'm a hog, so I might pass to my colleagues if they've got a question.
Mr. Macfarlane, Chris O'Brien from the ABC. I get the impression that you don't like the extreme polemic nature of the debate.
The extreme
and polemic nature of the debate. You know, you're either 100% for coal or 100% against it. So what would you say today to environmental concerns, to renewable energy proponents? What's your view of A, the pollution concerns of coal, and B, what proportion of our energy needs should come from renewables?
Well, to answer the second question first, Chris, the proportion of renewable energy that we draw needs to be a percentage that's reliable and dispatchable. That is, if I want to use renewable energy, I need to be able to use it now. I don't need to wait till the sun comes out or the wind starts to blow. So that's the first issue. The second issue is that it needs to be at a price which allows me to be internationally competitive in manufacturing in Australia. What's that percentage? The business as usual forecast would say that that's probably around 35-36%. It may be higher or lower depending on energy demand, but what is the ideal number? More is better, providing it's reliable and dispatchable. In terms of what do I say to people who are concerned about the environment, and aren't we all? My roof's covered in solar panels, absolutely covered, from the garage right through to the back fence. What do I say to them is we need to ensure that we have a transition that doesn't close down industry and jobs in Australia. Surely it's far better to replace a power station like Hazelwood that's emitting 1600 kilograms per megawatt hour with a power station that's emitting less than 700 kilograms per megawatt hour than replace it with probably something like 4000 megawatts of solar produce the same amount of energy and not have either the reliability or the low-cost energy from it. You'll achieve pretty much the same emission reduction. But if we're going to have a transition to renewables, and we're all working on that, then you do need to put in place a transition plan. At the moment, it's all renewables and blackouts, or it's coal and no one's going to invest. So I think we do need a plan, and as I say, we need a plan that's going to be accepted by both sides of government.
Mr. Macfarlane, Jeff Egan from News Regional here. You mentioned that you don't expect the activist court challenges to stop anytime soon. What specific changes would you like to see to the law to change these challenges in court?
Well, look, appropriation of costs would be a good start. They have various means of ensuring that they can tie a project up for 6 months and not face costs. What we need is an acceptance, though, of democracy. I mean, if the best public servants in Queensland and the best scientists in Queensland and nationally accept that a project is viable and is done in an environmentally friendly way, why should that be challenged constantly and continuously in a court by those people who aren't looking for an outcome simply but to delay it? So what we need is a process where we have a legal process that's not abused, it's not used in the way in which it was intended. It was intended to be a court of appeal. It's now being used as a court of delay. We need a process where costs are attributed, where those people who have no economic interest in the development of this state are actually held to account for their actions. And I wouldn't mind seeing their donations declared either. Having had to declare every donation I've had made to me as a politician that was worth more than $300, I wonder why we don't have the same rules for activists, and I also wonder why we don't have, why we continue to allow foreign donations into activism in Australia, just as I wonder why we allow foreign donations into politics, just by the way.
Is there another question from the table there?
Felicity Caldwell from Brisbane Times. You mentioned that the activists have got about $100 million in total. Would you hope that people might donate a similar amount to the resources industry, create a bit of a war chest to campaign ahead of the next election?
Well, I don't think it's about having a war chest. I think it's about people basing their arguments on fact and science. And it's not how much money we've got. It's about whether or not our arguments get given the same credence as some of the environmental arguments. And so that's hence why I put that last slide up. The reality is that this shouldn't be about money. It should be about people being able to present evidence, whether it's during an EIS project process or whether it's in a court of law. It shouldn't be about how much money can we put into an organisation to make sure a resource project happens. So we're not asking for $100 million. We are questioning why some of these organisations don't have to declare their donations and why they have tax deductible status. But the resource industry is happy to continue with what we've got and argue our argument. We just ask that particularly the media report those arguments in a balanced way.
Ms. Macfarlane, Stuart Late from AAP. You just clarification on something you mentioned earlier. The LNP and the federal government have talked about a coal-fired power station in North Queensland. You mentioned that you perhaps don't think that's a good idea, and if you don't,
no.
Where do you think that should be built?
No, I didn't say that at all. I said that to build a large power station in North Queensland is probably difficult. If you want to build a 400 to 500 megawatt heli in North Queensland, there's more than enough local demand to satisfy that, and you could perhaps build it on the basis that you then added a later stage and exported electricity down into central Queensland as those coal-fired power stations there start to age. But if you want to build a very large power station, and it's starting to look like we'll need a few, then certainly there are options in southern New South Wales and southern Queensland. But obviously, as someone who thinks there should be cheaper, more affordable power in North Queensland, I'd welcome the construction of a power station. I'm just realistic about the size that power station would be initially.
Mr. Macfarlane, Anthony Marks of the Courier-Mail. Regarding Adani's Carmichael project, it looks like there's still issues surrounding funding, whether banks are going to come to the party on that, possible further legal delays, environmental activists talking about blockading the site, et cetera. How confident are you that this project will eventually get up?
Well, I'm very confident, and I'm dismayed that there will be further delaying tactics employed against that project by those people who really don't understand that coal mined at Carmichael and burned in India will emit far less CO2 and far less sulphur dioxide than coal mined in other countries under far less stringent environmental conditions and burnt in India. If I was an environmentalist, and I am, and I wanted to see electricity delivered with the lowest possible emission signature, then I'd be mining coal at Carmichael compared to mining it in, let's say, Indonesia, where the sulphur levels are higher and where NOx and other pollutants are higher. So if you want a low ash, high thermal content coal, there is no better place to go than Queensland and Carmichael. And if you want to minimise the environmental impact of a coal-fired power station, A, you build a heli, B, you burn Queensland coal.
Just one more, Mark.
Oh, sorry.
Mr. Macfarlane is a very popular, highly influential former member of a coalition government.
I would have been disappointed if you hadn't asked this question, Chris.
You knew it was coming. Can't let you go. Apparently, the Liberal Party is hemorrhaging members federally. Campbell Newman says the Prime Minister should go. Are you still a member of the Liberal Party? Do you think the Liberal Party is in good shape?
I am still a member of the LNP, and I've always followed the model that John Howard gave, and that was not to publicly comment on issues within the party if I'm not involved. So I'm no longer an active member. I am a member. I think, as I said on 2GB the other day, I think all Australians are hankering for a government that just gets on and governs. And I have to say that we need to see a bit of that in Australia, right across the board, not just federally.
Ian, just one more question before we go. You kindly gave the AFR a plug with a front page story today about Queensland, some would say, propping up the NEM since the closure of Hazelwood. Some would say, well, that's how the NEM's meant to work. If there's not enough power being produced in one state, it's brought over from another.
Yep.
Queensland has the coal power to be able to do that at the moment. Do you believe Queensland will still be able to do that if it moves from its current 7% renewables to 50% within the next decade?
Well, what its renewable target is really a factor of price and reliability, and it's not contingent on mining coal. Certainly, the development of a coal-fired power station or three in eastern Australia is virtually inevitable. Why not have them in Queensland? Why not be burning the best coal? Why not have a situation where we export that energy to other states? We can still have a 50% renewable target if that's achievable at a dispatchable, reliable price. But other states aren't going to have those sort of luxuries. It's not Queensland's coal-fired power stations that will be closing down, as you rightly pointed out. The last coal-fired power station built in Australia was built on the Western Darling Downs. And I think we have four of the five most efficient power stations in Australia. It's the other states that are going to face the problems, particularly Victoria and also New South Wales. And for us to build a coal-fired power station, export that energy interstate, perhaps supply some of it into our own domestic market and create some jobs here, just seems like a smart thing to do if we are the smart state.
Ian, thanks for your time. Ladies and gentlemen, can you please thank Ian Macfarlane? Thanks very much again, Ian. Please visit the Queensland Media Club's website for a visual recording of today's speech if you want to watch it a second time, powered by Media Visions. You can also visit our website to keep informed of upcoming speakers and dates or to download past speeches if you are so inclined. I'd once again like to acknowledge our naming rights sponsors, Brisbane Airport Corporation, Civil Contractors Federation and Griffith Uni, as well as our other sponsors.
If you'd like to receive information about the Queensland Media Club season, please drop your business card in the bowl at the registration desk on your way out. And thanks very much for coming along today.